Welcome back. This is ride number two. Don't know where I'm going to go today. Just testing out some more stuff, basically. Had a hell of a time getting number one up on YouTube. So I'm trying some different settings today. It's a beautiful morning. 9:30 or so on Saturday. Figure we'll just take a little ride down the coast a bit. See what's going on. Shouldn't be any kind of heavy traffic. Garage sale. Lots of garage sales around here every weekend. Wife and I, nice bike there, BMW. Wife and I took a two-up ride around one of the local little towns last night. And I wasn't really paying attention to people, but she said we got a lot of stares and thumbs up. That's pretty cool. What are you doing? You're going to park on the lawn. That's great. Another garage sale. I wasn't kidding. So here's the road we have to go down that's, I guess, the quickest. It's not the closest, but it's the quickest to get to US 19 now. Beautiful weather out. I'm still in touring mode. Thought it felt a little strange. Let's change that. There we go. Feels a little... You know what? I think I'm... Yep, I'm still in two-rider mode, too. I don't think I can change that when I'm moving. So I'm going to go ahead and pull in here. Change that up. I can definitely tell that difference. Got the tires all scrubbed in now, so I don't have to be so antsy about it. Alright, let's see. I'm stopped. Yeah, see, there we go. Now I can adjust the finer points of the suspension because I'm stopped. You can adjust the touring mode here just by letting off the throttle, but for the suspension stuff, besides just going between soft, standard, and hard, you gotta be stopped. So let's see. There we go. Going down. I can feel the bike lowering. Go down one more. Lowers a lot faster than it raises. Took about... Oh, well, that's a big difference between one rider with luggage and just two riders. That was a big difference. I can go down a little bit more. That's a tiny difference. So they're not equal between 1, 2, 3, and 4. We're in the lowest setting right now to single rider. And it goes up a little bit there. Huh. That's interesting. You know what? I'm going to try just regular single rider. Because as small of a difference that makes, I don't think... I don't know. I mean, I'm bouncing on the bike, trying to adjust the squat. I'll go back here. And then, let's see, should have more settings in the dampening, too. Whew, it's getting kind of warm sitting here. So let's see. Yeah, so we can adjust between soft, standard, and hard, and we can also fine-tune them. Like, say we're in standard, we can go up or down three from those. So you got a total of 7 settings per main setting for 21 total. I don't know if anybody's going to feel the finalities of that. I'll just stay in standard for now. Haven't got enough seat time to know the differences. So there you go. But I do like having the control, that's for sure. Man, I'll tell you, the torque in this thing, it almost feels like you're in a really powerful car without a seatbelt, because you get so much more movement in your back. Well, at least I do right now, because I'm not used to it yet, but I feel like I'm in a car without a seatbelt. Here's my main shopping center. That's where what used to be my favorite grocery store is, and my barber, and my shipping store. And it really pissed me off when that grocery store closed. They were a Sweet Bay, which is a small, or was a small, Florida chain. Awesome place. When we moved down here, when I moved down here in 99, they were known as a really high-end, gourmet, import, you know, all the weird stuff. They were organic before organic was a thing. And they flopped. But I loved them because they had my favorite coffee, Illy, and I could get the pods there for my espresso machine, and they were the only place that stocked them, other than Williams and Sonoma, but they're off in the mall. So I loved Sweet Bay for that. So they rebranded and they tried to go budget. I guess there's no competing in the middle ground, so you're either a budget grocer or you're a high-end. Well, they didn't do so well there either, and basically got bought out by Winn-Dixie at the end, which is like freaking step up from the dollar store. They're all over the place here. They already were, but they bought out that Sweet Bay, closed it, rebranded it. So far, everything except the prices is the same. Everything went up like crazy, which is ridiculous because it's a Winn-Dixie. But they're still the only grocery store around here with a good seafood counter. So when I want fish, well, I gotta go there. But to give you an idea, I used to get big old nice salmon fillets. You know, farm raised, but still damn good. They'd go on sale all the time for $5.99 or $6.99 a pound. Well, here, as a Winn-Dixie, you're lucky to get them on sale for $9.99 a pound, same fish. Well, for $9.99 a pound, I can drive a little bit further over to my specialty fish market and get imported salmon from Scotland that are a hell of a lot better. And I used to do that when I would specifically want them, because they're extra thick. They're really awesome. But for the everyday stuff, they're not worth $9.99 a pound. They're, you know, $6.7, no problem, that's it. And then they also have this rewards card thing, which basically they want you to think you're saving all kinds of money. And they give you a receipt that says, oh, you saved so many dollars. No, they just marked it up to begin with. And it's really obvious to those of us that were shopping there before, the prices went up. And then you use the card and it comes back down to what it was. So you can't jack up the price a dollar and then put it on sale for a dollar off and say you're saving money. And so many people fall for it, it's not even funny. But they just piss me off like that. But it's the only really close store. It's the only one with a lot of the stuff that I buy, so I don't really have a choice. I just have to pick and choose what I get there now. Luckily, they haven't messed with what they stock. So the brands that I'm used to are still there, so that's good. Speaking of which, they're also tied in with this fuel perks thing. I was just looking at the gas station there, remembering. Last night, I looked at the receipt and it said, you had $37 in fuel savings. I'm like, oh, okay, wow, that's a whole tank of gas. I guess I'll actually pay attention to this now. So I look at it and I go online to see how to activate it or use it. And there's a few gas stations around here that are participating in it. So I look into the details, and no, it's not you have $37. That is how many imaginary dollars you've saved that they jacked up. What you get in fuel is 5 cents a gallon off for every $50 you spend. So I was up to, I've been shopping there a few months, and I was up to like 37 cents off per gallon. And it expires. There's a shelf life on these fuel perks. So I'm almost at the end of a tank now, and my points do expire at the end of the month or a couple weeks. So I gotta go find a gas station and, you know, okay, it'll bring it just down under $2 a gallon. So that's not bad, I guess. But I was bummed. I thought I had a free tank of gas, which would make it a lot more worth it. But man, spending $50 on jacked up groceries just to save 5 cents a gallon, I don't think that's worth it. I know a lot of people, I see posts on Facebook about, thanks Winn-Dixie, and you know, their gas pump is reading like
9 cents a gallon.
Well dang, how much did you spend at Winn-Dixie to get that kind of a discount, and how much did you waste? A heck of a lot more than you're saving in gas. So I'm going down alternate 19 here. That main road we were on shortly was US 19. That actually goes from St. Petersburg down at the bottom of the peninsula all the way up to New York. And before the interstate, it was the major route. And you can still take it all the way up there. For most of the way through Florida, it's actually really nice. It's a four-lane divided highway. Once you get out of all these cities that are down here in Pasco and up in Hernando, once you go north about 45 minutes and get out of all this traffic, it opens up. And it actually gets very, very desolate. I've gone up, I've ridden up, and I've driven up to areas up there called Cedar Key. And it's a really nice coastal swampland kind of retreat city, town. And what's really cool up there is it's one of the very few places in Florida with what's classified as a dark sky. So you can do astrophotography. And I went up there to take photos of the Milky Way, which is amazing to do in Florida. It's a little easier these days. If I had one of the brand new cameras that are out, I could crank up the ISO like crazy and do it a little bit easier, but I had to go up there to do it. It's about 3.5-4 hours each way. You have to go up there because you have to get away from all the light pollution. You have to be 20 some odd miles minimum away from any big light source. And that's one of the few. There's a couple spots down in the Everglades. That's it for the entire state. It's a very, very light polluted state. We don't have any laws about lights facing up. The skies are always lit up around here 24/7. You don't see the stars at all. Mostly you just see reflected cloud light. That's just the way it is. There's a lot of places up north and a ton of places out west. I mean, it's totally common to see dark skies up north. I gotta get used to the motorcycle wave. I dissed a couple guys unintentionally yesterday. They waved and I'm like, oh yeah, yeah, forgot that's a thing. I don't really care about it. Nothing against it. But sometimes it's just kind of annoying, especially if you pass a whole bunch of them at the same time. It's like, I don't want to just hang my arm down. So here we've got Tarpon Springs. This is one of the very few ethnic-themed communities in the entire Tampa Bay area. A lot of large cities, including Detroit, where I'm from, you've got little sections. You know, you've got Little China, or Chinatown, you've got Little Italy. Up in Detroit, we had Greektown, and this is the equivalent of Greektown. This is Tarpon Springs, and it's pretty much an entirely Greek-populated city. And this is the main downtown attraction. This is called the Sponge Docks, and they are working sponge docks, diving boats, and they produce something like 80% of the world's natural sponge right out of here. I don't have a really use for sponge, but a lot of people do. You can buy it dirt cheap here, I understand. There's tons of shops, of course, that sell it. It does feel cool. I mean, it's not like synthetic sponge, but that's all I use, you know, for washing the car or whatever. I don't use it in the shower. But a lot of people do. They got a small aquarium that does tours, lots and lots of shopping. I mean, this is 100% tourist area, basically. But there are some damn good restaurants. Not quite as good as up north, I think, but it is authentic. It's, of course, geared towards the tourist area, so it's not the really weird Greek stuff. You know, you got your gyros. Yeah, I can't say it with these cheek pads. Gyros. There we go. And your saganaki. And your moussaka. Love that movie. So it's just a little area with lots of shopping and really expensive parking. It's crazy expensive to park here. $5-$10 to get a spot because all the lots are private. There is no public parking. So they got a nice little racket going on. Some homemade fudge, lots of dessert stores, baklava, lots of woman's apparel, handbags. My wife's been down here to buy some handbags, lots of shoes and sandals and hats, basically anything. Hella's is a pretty good restaurant, but there's a better one just around the corner, Mr. Saganaki's. Insane portions. I mean, really good food. Cost you $10-$15 a person if you're really hungry, and you're taking home a box with a whole separate meal. And back in here, you got like a little courtyard with more shops. So it's a very large area and just a small amount of space. And of course, they have boat tours you can do. You can go out on a couple of the actual sponging boats. And they've got dolphin watching tours. That's real popular around any of the bays and any of the docks here. Here's a sightseeing tour out of there. Another dolphin cruise. All kinds of stuff. And that's fun to do with people from out of town. I haven't done them in years because, you know, once you see it enough, you're done. Another really good Greek restaurant there. Haven't been there in a while, but they're more upscale, more fine dining, if you can imagine fine dining Greek. Oh, cool. Nice old mini. A lot of cigar stores, but they suck. Any of the cigar stores around the tourist areas suck. I actually know the owner of that one. Hope he's not watching, but his stuff really sucks. A lot of dive shops. Scuba is very popular around here. We've got great water for diving. I haven't been in years. I should do that again. Mr. Suvaki said the wrong name earlier. Good stuff. Really good stuff. If you're in Tarpon Springs, definitely hit them up for dinner or lunch. You won't regret it. Tap House just burned down. That was a really fun little bar that my wife would go to a lot because her school that she teaches at is just down the street. And they would all meet there frequently for drinks, hang out, have retirement parties, whatever. And it burned down a few weeks ago. I didn't hear if they figured out what was wrong, but it started somewhere in the kitchen. Someone said they smelled smoke behind a wall, and the whole place, it was populated, whole place went up in minutes. And I guess it was a very intense 2-alarm fire, and it was burning down trees around the place. And they even had to evacuate the restaurant next door. So it's gone, that's for sure. Had a couple places burned down around here recently. Kind of makes you wonder. That's a big Greek church. A lot of weddings are held there. It's pretty much the only nice church in this entire area, and it's the only nice Greek church, period. There's a couple Jewish temples, but nothing much goes on there, because when you do any kind of ceremony, they don't allow photography for pretty much everything. So not much gets used there. But that Greek church, oh man, all the time. Because it's fairly nice looking inside, and it's one of the older buildings. Nothing is really old in the entire Tampa Bay area. It's not like we've got old architecture or, you know, beautiful art deco like Miami or anything gothic like up north. Nope, nope. Everything here is 50 to 100 years old max, most in the 50 to 60 year range. And that's about it. This area was founded on the railroads. Tampa exists because they ran a line down to it. It was just swamp. Same thing with Miami. A lot of bike nights. It's Saturday, so there's probably about 10 going on in the area. I'm going to cover some of them. I want to cover a whole lot eventually. There's a lot on it. I think every day except Sunday, you can hit multiple bike nights. What is with the Harley riders not giving like any notice to non-Harley riders? Never understood that. They just kind of keep up the stereotype. They only ride on the weekends around here, and if you're not riding a Harley, you're shit. Met some that are nice, but I don't know, at least around here, that's the attitude. Support bike riders, they like anybody. A lot of golf courses. So this alternate 19 runs alongside US 19. And it goes down, it just kind of hugs the coast. Water's only a couple blocks that way. Right in back of these buildings here is the Pinellas Trail, which is a biking and walking path that runs for 20 some odd miles. Starts way up here and goes all the way down to St. Pete. And I biked that a couple times on HLO. One of them was with Dave Blanco from Blanco Cigars, and we biked it for about half the length. He's done the whole thing, I just didn't have time. So we did about 10 miles up and 10 miles back. We started around his place in Safety Harbor. Really, really nice trail. I wish we had that up by us or some way to get to it up by us. But there just isn't. I mean, there isn't even sidewalk to get to some of the parts up by us. But down here at Pinellas, they're spoiled. They've got lots of trails like that. Great biking access. But we have to drive somewhere and bring the bike with us. But you never know it's there. It's hidden really well. And then right on the other side of that is the Gulf of Mexico. And this road just kind of hugs it, goes all the way down. Where does this end? Oh, this actually ends kind of right in the middle of the beaches. It doesn't go along into the beaches, but it stays on the mainland. All the beaches down here in Pinellas County, you've got, starts with North Clearwater Beach and then goes South Clearwater Beach. Then you've got, there's like 20 of them. Treasure Island, Madeira Beach, Reddington Shores, Indian Shores, St. Pete Beach, a whole bunch of them. And some of them are only like a half mile long. You don't know you've gone from one to the other except a little sign on the road. Just little municipalities, but they're just half a mile wide at the most. You got one road going up and down all of them. And then down in St. Pete Beach, it widens a little bit, and that's where you have all the big hotels. And that's where I do most of my wedding work. That's where a lot of the weddings are, on the beach, and you know, people getting married in the hotels. There's a couple now, actually, on Clearwater Beach, because that whole area has completely changed, 100% changed since I moved down. When I came down here, both Clearwater beaches were just pretty small. The biggest building was a little two-story motel. Just realized I'm going really slow. Things go, put the visor down here. I gotta adjust this every single time I put the visor down now. Say a command. Shut up, Senna. Cancel. See, it doesn't even recognize my voice. Cancel. Oh, there we go. So annoying. I figured out a way of doing it gently to put it up. I can, instead of just grabbing the tab, like I did with my old visor, I kind of put my thumb on the helmet and lift it with one finger, and it has a little bit more gentle control. But coming down, it still vibrates the heck out of the helmet. Maybe I can turn off that tapping feature. I don't know. I'll have to look at it. But anyway, yeah, St. Pete Beach, Clearwater Beach, totally different. Now there's high-rise hotels, big ones. Now there's, finally, this is a good thing, a huge parking garage. Parking was always an issue down there before, but what they did is they completely gutted the beach. I mean, tore out the road, tore out buildings, everything. Basically leveled it, bought up all the old small buildings, tore them down, put up huge condos, huge hotels, you know, 20-story huge complexes. And now it looks like a miniature South Beach, the way they've done it up. And that's kind of what they're going for. But the problem is they didn't add any parking. They took out all the free parking and put in metered lots, but there weren't even as many of them as there were before. So finally, when they put in this last huge hotel, they attached a really huge parking garage to it. And it's not cheap. It's $20 for the day, but it's at least really good parking access. And it's right across from the beach. Right next to the pier, which is a big tourist attraction. I'll show you if we go down there. I guess we can. Be a long video, but hey, why not? It's still testing. Alright, well, I think I'll trim this off here and pick back up when we get to something more interesting, because there's a bit of road going down to there. Well, I changed my mind. That would make this video like an hour and a half long ride, so I gotta work on trimming my stuff down. So I'm gonna go back up US 19. I turned off alternate here. We're on Tampa Road, and this goes predictably all the way into Tampa. We'll head on back the faster way. Alternate 19 is a nice little ride, but it is not the fast way to get anywhere. Unless I'm going to Tarpon, I pretty much never take it, because there's no point. I tell you, it's nice wearing glasses, because I can keep the visor up much longer than if I didn't have them, because the wind doesn't bother my eyes. But I had different glasses when I had the last bike. They were bigger. These are nice because they're frameless, they're rimless, so I don't see any kind of distraction, but the lenses are physically a little bit smaller, so I see the edges, which means my glasses are the limits of my visibility. Which is fine, because obviously I'm used to that. But it's something I noticed that I didn't have last time. The helmet was the limiting factor. And I guess looking to the side, they definitely did improve the side visibility, because in my normal peripheral vision looking forward, I can't see the helmet at all. I have to look all the way left or all the way right just to see the edge of my helmet. Huh, good jobs, showy. Up and down, really can't notice the difference. I can just barely see the top of the camera. Actually, I'm looking at just the tip of the lens bezel. So that's no big deal there. Was that bird crap or water? I saw something drip down. Oh, man. You guys can't see it, but there's like 1,000 ants coming out of that guy's back hatch. I'm like, wow, why is that moving? It's a huge line of ants. So he's got an infestation in his car. That sucks. That would freak me out if I had them crawling all over me while I was driving or something. Woo! Man, there's a lot of them. You turning or what, dude? This PT Cruiser doesn't know what the hell he's doing. Oh, now you're just going to go left and turn around because you don't know where you are. That's great. Beautiful morning out. This is just absolutely perfect. Oh, shoot. There's US 19. See, I'm not used to coming down this road. The other one I come down has a real big intersection for it. Dedicated turn lanes. This one is just a normal little road. So I'll flip around. There's my old BMW dealer down there, where we got the minis. Spent a lot of time down there, buying stuff, fixing stuff. Then they opened a new one. It was farther away, but much better prices. I used to get parts to do an oil change. They have an actual oil change kit, where they give you the crush washer and the filter and the oil and a new O-ring. And it was like 15 bucks cheaper at this new dealer that opened up. And I wasn't even going to use them, but they opened and then they sent, I don't know how they got everybody's names, but they sent local owners a special coupon. And said, hey, come on in and, you know, check out the dealership. And we'll give you an oil change for 20 bucks. I'm like, 20 bucks? Hell yeah, that's more than half off, even doing it myself with the BMW stuff. And I was impressed. They were good guys, so they were worth the extra 10, 15 minute drive. They're out in Wesley Chapel. And that's where I ended up selling my Mini and picking up my used Kia Soul. It was only a year old. And they gave me exactly what I wanted for the car, which I was surprised about. And that was that. We had the wife's Mini fixed there under warranty a few times, and it actually convinced us to sell them. She had a 2007 Cooper S, so it was the turbo version. Mine was the 2005. It was the supercharged version, completely different cars. Mine was insanely more reliable than hers. Mine was still the old design by Rover, built by BMW. Hers was 100% BMW, and they just ruined it. Well, that's another story for another day. But we were in there for one repair. It was like a $400 turbo valve that went out. Ridiculous. And while we're in there, they're like, oh yeah, by the way, your timing chain is gone and it's a $2,500 repair. You need to do it right away. We're like, no. Took it right down to the Kia dealer, right from the dealer. And she bought a new Soul, traded in the Mini. They gave us a okay price on the car, all things considered. And we were happy to get rid of it. And that was it. I sold mine just, I don't know, a couple months later. Because I was so impressed with her soul. Especially the usability of it. You know, as a photographer, I have a lot of gear to carry. And it's more than twice the space in the back. Especially for light stands and soft boxes and all that kind of stuff. Just so much easier to drive. When I'd go to a client's house and, you know, they'd have a rough driveway or something, that Mini would take a beating. Almost no ground clearance, low profile tires, just a pain. And the sole, man, you don't have to worry about it. Comfy, good ride height, really nice on long trips, a lot more comfortable to just sit back and relax. So I dig that. All right, well, I got a little ways here yet to go back home. Guess I'll finish this off here. This will be a good test number two. I'm going to have tour. Oh, I did want to mention one more thing. When I got the SMH10 in yesterday, I immediately did a test. Turns out the mic issue is not with this 20S. It still has other issues. It's still going back. But the mic issue is with the receiver, the GP10 unit. Which means I have to send that back also, which means I can't do any motovlogs until I get it back. So it's going to be a week or so after I send it back until I can do another on-road video, which sucks. But I'm not spending another $100 to buy another one in the meantime. I didn't mind buying another communications module because I wanted another one for the wife anyway. But I have no use for another GoPro pack. So I'm just going to have to go without. So, I'm not sure if this will be the last video, because they haven't even given me the label yet to send it back. But I'll let you know, the last one before I send it back, there will be a few or several days delay. So that's what's going on with that. Anyway, thanks for watching, guys. Don't forget to subscribe, give me a thumbs up, share the video. If you are another motovlogger, definitely email me. I want to get you up on the site. Absolutely no cost or anything like that. I just want to promote other motovloggers and help everyone get exposure and more views. And that's it. If you are watching this and you watch other motovloggers that you like, send them my way. You know, tell them, hey, twowheelobsession.com, man. Get your videos up there. Totally free. All right. See you later, guys.